What's up, guys? Welcome to week two, part two of a series I'm doing to preview the ESC map of the week. The scheduled map for week two of this season is Koth Pro Viaduct RC3. With me today, I have Pure. I'm going to be calling him Brad for most of this. He's going to be going over demo, and then he's probably going to be bailing. I also have Brandon, or Seagull, here to talk a little bit about Soldier and possibly Scout. He has never scouted this map. This will be his first season there. He has done really well in the past on Soldier, pocket role, I believe, on Blight a few seasons ago. And I will be talking about Medic and Scout a little bit later on. We're going to lead off with Demo, and then stick around for the other sections. I will upload this to my YouTube. I believe my YouTube is The Sean Bud. If you guys want to subscribe over there. Also follow my Twitter, which is @SeanBud. And follow my stream, which is twitch.tv/SeanBud. So if you guys want to make sure you follow that, I would appreciate that greatly. But right now, let's get started. Brad, do you want to start talking about demo?
The big Sean.
I guess let's do introductions. I introduced you guys off mumble, but we have Pure here. Pure, say hi to the YouTubes.
What's up, Sean's fans and supporters of the laser beams? How's everyone doing tonight? I'm sure everyone's peachy keen. Maybe just watching the end of our match right there. Who's on the other side of the table? Me, right here.
We've got Seagull. Seagull, who I'll be referring to as Brandon.
Hello. I usually play Soldier, but
yes, I kind of informed them a little bit of that. Talk about when you've played Viaduct. I know you played like season 5, 6. Was Viaduct even in the rotation then?
Yeah, I've only played Viaduct for, I guess this would be my third season. It was first implemented in season 5, and that's when the first strats first came about. Then this is actually Pro Viaduct, which came about later. Yeah, I've been playing this map for a while.
And you played this 2 seasons ago with Blight, is that correct? You played Pocket there?
With Experiment.
Yeah. Oh, with Experiment, that's right. Okay. Okay, so let's lead off with Brad. Let's talk about, I guess I generally talk about, strats for pushing, strats for holding, what to do during the mid-fights. Do you want to show them rollouts? A couple different rollouts?
Yeah, I was about to say,
start with?
Follow me over here, brother.
I'm going to spec you, and I'll just have them watch you during the rollout.
Cheatron, in case you need overheal, Brad.
Oh my god. No, hang on, Brad, I got to switch my overlay here. Alright. Go ahead, Brad. Thank you, guys.
The basic one, you just want to come to the door, and you're going to get 260, and you're going to take the first sticky right through. And when you get here, you can either, if you think you're like crazy good, you can put a sticky down and go towards middle. But most of the time, you're just pre-charging a sticky right here. And you can basically always want to clear the right over there, because there could either be the demo walking up. And if the demo's not there, that means you know you can take the right side, because there's no scouts coming up. So right here, you own middle, depending on how you want to take it. But if you hit the demo with damage, it depends on how it sounds. If you barely touch him, you know you might have a fight with him. He might like rotate, and you might have to shoot with him. Or if it's a deep thud, you know he's taking damage, and you can make one of two choices. This is at the end of rollout here. If you decide to go after the demo, other things are going to rotate on you. The trick is, if you hear heavy damage as a demo, you want to rotate to either the left or the right, and you want to start pre-firing and taking that on. Because what you're doing right now is you just took this area and you hit heavy damage and you controlled it for a second, and then you came over here and denied it. So you're covering two areas at one time, and then if anything happens to walk in here, nothing else is going to be supporting it, so it's going to get shot by whatever else is on your team. So, I mean, you can do other rollouts where you go through the side, but there's nothing really. I mean, Brandon, would you ever really say that you can go through the side and walk up where the big pack is, like on the side over here, and cover right? Sometimes demos do that. They come up right and they pre-sticky over here. But I don't know, man. The game is lost in one coming out of main rolling out.
I think that would be more of a gimmick rollout in case. Let's say you notice after one or two rounds that someone rushes that hallway. Maybe you would try and rush that and get a pre-sticky kill.
Yes. Yep. It's true. If you get there quick enough, if you hit the jumps right, you can get there before the roamer. And the roamer's like, oh shit, there's 3 stickies there. So he RJ's over and like, you know, he's not going to like jump right at you. But so you keep him back and whatnot. I think the most powerful part of Demo Man on this map is having the point and just holding it off with stickies. whenever I've watched demo men on my team, and no matter what class I'm playing, I always am a pest about saying reload your stickies, sticky the point. Because what people do is they'll hit people with damage, and they'll be like, oh, that's awesome, and they'll be like doing this and whatnot and firing damage. But in reality, their main play just should have been, oh, they hit damage, nice. Like that. That should be their play all the time on Viaduct, because nothing matters besides capping the point. And even if things creep up here right on you, they're not on you. And if things creep up here on you, you're going to be able to fight them. And look what you have already right here, a wall. So it's like in chess, Brandon, you know, when your king is set up, you have the three pawns to the far side. So if you get the pieces out a certain way, you can castle your king. It's the same thing with putting up stickies in certain spots, you know. You just cover areas.
This is next level. No, I appreciate the castle reference in TF2.
Do you have any interesting sticky spots you like to use?
Yeah, let's do it, right? I guess the new metagame is that when you crush a team, you put your team all the way up here, no matter what. People have different styles, assortments, but this is just the way it goes. The power move is that you don't have to make it too fancy. You just put, like, at least three stickies in a couple spots over here, and you're not necessarily trying to kill anything, but when you choose to fight them, you can put your fire in certain directions, and you're able to filter people certain ways. Meaning, like, if they're coming in here and you're shooting there, they're like, okay, what? You might do that. Or if he's doing that, he's like, why is he missing all these shots and do that? Like a YZ-50 or something, you know? Someone trying to test you.
So this would be, after a successful middle when you guys push aggressively?
Yeah. I mean, most teams will, you know, we'll probably do this. Lang hops on this rock. You hop on this rock as a medic. And you come over here and, you know, I put a couple stickies and then, you know, you wait for the comms. So if they're like, oh, if they're on the right, okay, let's fire some damage. But generally, out of the 100 or so people watching, I'm sure 120 of you know it, but if you want to do really good damage to people in an area we call China, we call this China right here, in this area, and then if the call ever had to be made, it's Japan is right back here. So if someone was ever, like, a route to come behind Shambut, I would yell Japan. But the whole point is, right over here, rockets and stickies, I don't think they do full damage, Brandon. What's they do? Splash from the other side?
I think they.
Hang
full.
On, I just got dropped because I was AFK apparently. Oh. If you can remove that from our server config. All right, go ahead.
For the people who don't know, this does really heavy damage. So if I was ever, you know, constantly in a fight and reloading as a demo man, let's say I have five stickies right now, and I could do is just put like two right there or three right there and back up. Because what it's going to do is, if anything walks through over there and walks through, you're going to dead on it. But if it walks through and goes backwards, you can dead on it and kill him. So don't worry. Like, definitely use that. But Brandon, I'd say, what sticky trap scares you the most in this map? Like the little patches hidden in the rocks if you're trying to retake middle or something? As a soldier entering middle on me, you know?
I would say the most dangerous ones aren't the ones that are just, you know, hidden. The most dangerous ones are the ones I know are there, but I have to deal with them, and the entire time when I'm dealing with them, I have to take damage from the entire team. So the ones around the rock are really specifically annoying, because this rock is all angled, so it's not like I can just easily shoot one rocket, right? And, well, where are all those stickies going to go? They're all going to come flying at me. And I'm going to kill myself. And it works both ways, too. I mean, if you put stickies on that rock, how am I supposed to get them down from this side, too? It's like I shoot them and they come flying.
Well, you
at
drop
me.
Down here with your medic, but what do you say to your med? You're like, you know, drop down, stickies around the corner. But you can walk in here and bite. Once you're into here, you're probably going to pop. Would you pop right here and get into them?
Yeah.
Yeah, if you can get that far in without popping, then it's already a pretty good push.
Defensively, I mean, we could talk about demo man on this map for like 50 minutes, but defensively, you have to play it. You have to play it with stickies, like as reloaded as much as you can, and as much as you want to overkill and deny people. Just make sure you stay reloaded and keep resticking middle, because things will always just push on you. What's the timer at, dog? You said you were pulling out the timer. Are we at 11 minutes and 40 seconds?
We've got like 5 or so minutes left. I mean, you can keep 6 minutes, I guess. You can keep talking. We talked about holding a little bit. Maybe talk about how to push a little bit. Maybe like what to do on like suicides if you need to jump in.
I mean, the best flight path is you see this area here. There's like there's a lot of high area, versus the other side, which is blocked by that. And if you go this way, there's a skybox and a train thing. If you can look at like a perfect path, like look at this, like this point right here. It's you can go like, and you can go all the way through middle. So, I mean, 260 with a double sticky. How much damage would you do yourself? So let's see. Oopsie daisies. That is what was that? 130 like 70. To 70? Yeah, 60 to 70, right? So you do 120 to yourself, so you're in the air at like 140, 135. No, you probably get a tail buff, so you're in the air at like 160. 160 flying through middle? Let's see, that's too powerful. Too powerful. I don't know, bro.
Looks like we got some stuff to work out before Vladek's week. No, that's. I mean, it's just a suicide bomb. That's just a strat a lot of teams do to try to force the medic to pop, to try and get a better push the second time around. Usually, if you don't have Uber and you're pushing into their Uber, it's generally very, very difficult to win a push on Vladek. So people like they kind of sell out on the first jump and then try and get the second push to be much, much easier by suiciding two or three people, and that's when this would apply. And you can kind of improvise a lot of that stuff. You can't script too much, otherwise they're just gonna probably deny you incredibly well when you try to come in for it. So just any route you can get in and try and get damage on the medic or just get damage on other players is most ideal. You know, if you can walk in left for free, then maybe try it. But if they're holding cliff aggressively, you could walk out the left and then jump them and pinch them in that way. But there's lots of options. What else can we talk about, though? Just you talked about mids a lot. You talked about the mid fight. What about just like a? You talked about holding a little bit, but that's probably the most important point of demo on this map is just holding the point and defending against pushes.
A good setup. I mean, it depends on who you're talking to in this short of a span. If you're gonna do repushes for middle, and you basically, you know, let's say you have Uber advantage. Oh, we made them pop a while ago. Guys, let's get middle. Let's stop that time. Because, you know, you're always looking at the clock. I mean, there's multiple doors you can go in, but once you go through a door, it's what's behind the door that matters. And going right, you necessarily don't want to have to do right with a quick push because it's the flank. That's the flank. You really don't have to worry about the flank that much. So you either push out main really quickly, since it's a nice filter towards point. It's really close. Or you just go through left. You know, why do you go through left, Sean? Why is it the second one?
Height advantage?
Exactly, dog. You come over here, and it's still pretty close to mid, but you know what? You know what you get right here? This is beautiful. Basically for every class, because if you get too much damage here, you know what you do? You swoop in lower, and then keep going. So, definitely a good thing to do.
What else can you talk about on demo on this map?
Demo on this map?
Do you rock the paint train or not?
I mean, you can rock the pain train. I don't think I would, because scouts are just murderous on this map. I'm gonna be fighting scouts.
A lot of the DM fights come down to clearing scouts.
I think it's time for Brandon to explain some soldier concepts.
Yeah, that's a good 10-12 minutes about demo.
I'm gonna give away secrets. Let me change my overlay here. The best player in the game in this map. Oh, Tyrone? It's not. Oh, it's the Tyrone. Yeah, Tyrone. Best dude in the game on this map.
So I guess the first thing you'd probably want me to go over as soldier would be the rollout.
Yeah, a few mid rollouts. I don't know if you know any of the Roma rollouts, but if you could talk about a little bit about those as well.
Well, I think all the rollouts on this map are pretty much the same for soldiers because there's not really. Well, I don't know. I haven't really done the timings of it, but in teams teams for me in the past, what we do is neither soldier actually RJs to resupply cabinet, and instead we walk to the door and we both get 300 before we get the door because when you spawn, you have crit heals, and then it's the same thing.
Wait, Sean, are you there? Sean,
yeah, did my stream go down?
Your stream went down, but now it's fast forwarding up. It's fast forwarding up now. I think it was out for a second.
Yeah.
It's out for me. It's not on for me. Okay, I think it's back up. I think it's back up. Yeah, go ahead. Just start talking about the rollouts again, Brandon.
All right, well, welcome to Soldier on this map. The very first thing that I've done on my teams is... Well, it's always been kind of hard, because as Soldier, you want to break the habit of greenery and other maps where you just RJ straight to the cabinet, and then you walk. But on this map, the distance to mid is so short. I mean, you just go to here. It's like two RJs, I think, maybe. So instead, you just want to sit and spawn and then walk to this door. And then that way, you have crit heals and you can get 300 each. And then after that, you can RJ here. And from here, you can decide where you go and your medic can buff whoever he wants. Generally, if you're pocket, you're probably not going to be a solid 300. And you're, because you're going to be by your medic for most of the mid, because it depends on what your team's doing a lot of the time. But at least personally, I like playing this mid a lot more defensively than other soldiers, I feel. Because you can basically cut this mid into three different portions. Right here, you can sort of look at it, but there's a stupid lip on both sides, which means it cuts the map into this, this, and over here. And that means that if you're right here, you can shoot everyone who's on the point, and if they're projectile class, they can't shoot you back without getting a direct. So that means that if you're playing defensively right here, you will always have the advantage versus people who are on the point. And that means if you're on the point, you better make sure that you can push up really, really fast, or the other players are already on the same area as you.
What would you call it? A no man's land, if you will? If the combo's right there. If I was right here, you know, it's a no man's land for you to be there, but this person can just shimmy shake.
Yeah, he can destroy you. And so that means, essentially, as Pocket, my entire role on this map is sitting here, spamming people who attempt to cross the point, and then waiting for the roamer and spamming the fucking rock. I hate this rock so much.
You mean your rock defensively or their rock?
Both. Like, okay. It's so easy just to get free damage. Like, let's say I walk into mid, and generally I'll walk slow, and that way I'm topped off at 300 or whatever. The very first thing I'm going to do is spam one rocket at the rock. At the enemy rock.
Yeah, I'll probably tag a scout or something.
Yeah, if you get lucky, you direct a scout, and that scout can get it for 48, and he will be raging. And sometimes demomen get cocky, and they want to be fancy, and they'll sit on top of the rock, and you can direct them as well. And either way, it's free, it's nice, it's easy. And then after that, you're just looking for spam angles, and most of the time when I come in the middle as Pocket, I'm mostly directing my spam towards the flank, because, I mean, if we're all spamming, if both soldiers right here spamming across the no man's land, as Brad calls it, across from each other, we're probably not going to each other. It's going to come down to demo man versus enemy demo man in terms of spam damage. And so the only spam that's going to be reliable for me is going to be on flank. And flank spam is going to be always better than spam that's going towards enemy heals, right? Because, I mean, why would I want to hit the guy who's getting healed when I can hit the guy who isn't getting healed who's farther away from the medic? So the very first thing when I come to mid is walk here, shoot the rock, maybe jump up here. You get a nice position, and you can sort of jump and shoot over no man's land a little if you get lucky, I don't know. And you can start working the flank. And I always, generally, I just wait for the roamer to jump in and I kill them, or I wait for the enemy team to push up, and then I start pushing in.
So you like to play the mid a little more passively just in general, and like holding on this point, you like to play like right about where you are for just spamming the high ground?
Yeah, absolutely, as okay. Pocket. And then I wait for someone to go in or like something to happen, right? So let's say my roamer jumps in hard, then I'll follow it up, right? I'll just be like, boom, and follow it up. Or if one of my scouts gets a key pick on the flank, maybe that's my cue for starting to push across point, because now that we have a numbers advantage and stuff like that. But most of the time, I'm just sitting, I'm just waiting for that moment to strike, and I'm just keeping back the enemy. And if they start pushing across this, I'm just instantly going to just run into them and kill them if they start pushing across point without any actual advantage.
Yeah. Do you think you know, talk a little bit more about like the high ground? Like you said, it's divided into three sections. Do you think like if you're not doing damage on high ground, you should be jumping them? Because if you're pushing across trying to spam behind their rock, like isn't a demo much more effective like lobbing stickies over the rock and like down that slope? And do you think you'd be more effective just jumping them, getting aggressive on them?
Yeah, that's probably true in most cases. Except the thing is, if you do aggressive jump, at the same time people can just run by you if you're not careful. Like, yeah. Say a scout could just instantly just run under you and try and get your medic, and that's scary. And at the same time, you don't know what else could be coming towards your medic. So it just depends on the situation. Like, if you think you have advantage, and yeah, you never want to walk because you can just jump and actually do damage. But on the other hand, if you have a slight advantage, but at the same time they have maybe a flank class that's available who could come and flank you at any time, you don't want to push up too fast. You want to be able to be in the position to kill that guy who's going to come and flank your medic or whoever. So that's generally what I do as Pocket on mids. And as Roamer, I usually I love playing this left wall for some reason. I always come over on this side and I just wait, and then I just do a left-sided RJ and go straight in whichever side you want. And that's sort of the cue for my team. Or you can also push, as Brad was talking about, well, with some of his rollouts, you could push straight through here and just play the flank really, really hard. Because this spot, as a roamer, is actually pretty good, assuming that they don't somehow get behind you. Because you're safe from any and all spam from the combo, assuming that they're by the rock. And it's not like a scout can kill you. You're in the hallway. All you have to do is shoot your feet.
Yeah, I noticed a lot of good roamers play the pavement there where you're at really strong. Blaze and Dave AC, I think they kind of shade towards the tunnel. And talk about some like the cheeky things roamers can do. Like, yeah, I know a lot of them just go behind and collect health packs and like hide in house and shit like that.
Yeah, Dave AC loves to do that. I'd say all of the times I watched him last season, probably half of his plays on every mid were just RJ behind the enemy team somehow. Like, let's say he comes to here, you just do something, I don't know, cute, and let's say he actually landed that jump and goes all the way to their health back. I don't know. His RJs are amazing. He's really strong with just getting behind teams like that. But I don't have as much experience as Roamer on this map, so I don't really... There's, like, a bunch of really cool jumps you can do and, like, gimmicky stuff like that. But outside of that, I mean, that's sort of, like, mid-fight for soldiers in general is... just waiting for something to go on. Don't cross into no man's land unless you have a good reason, like an advantage, and keep spamming flank. As for when you win or lose it, though, there's a couple different ways you can play it. If you get a significant advantage, most teams nowadays are going to push up to here. And as pocket, there's, even though you can push up to forward, like let's say for some reason they have all six down, you could actually take your medic and walk all the way up top, which is probably like the best position. Because, I mean, if you have high ground on top of being playing forward, that's really, really good. But most of the time, I feel, when I'm playing pocket, I don't have that much time. Like, I'm not rolling a team that hard. I'm just going to be sitting down here. And as pocket, generally what's going to happen is it's going to be you and a medic hanging out underneath this silly bridge. And then your demo man's going to be somewhat nearby. And you're going to have at least one scout and a roamer sitting on this side watching this. Because your roamer can sit here and he can watch this flank and middle, and he can get a preemptive call because he has the angle on both ends. And then when you get that call from your roamer, you're going to be 300, and your entire goal in life is to make sure that you can land the jump before they get out the choke. Like, let's say you're sitting here and you hear the roamer call, you can instantly jump over there and start pre-firing this corner, and before they can even get out the door, if you land those rockets, you've killed an entire enemy push or suicide. It is so good.
So you forward, prefer like aggressive holds if you have like an uber advantage or number advantage?
Yeah, any advantage period, I just love aggressive holds. Because I just really don't like the fact that sometimes you can just get unlucky. And
yeah.
If you're playing back, sometimes some soldier's going to go absolutely crazy, like hit your medic, your medic's going to surf, and maybe he'll just land some TLR fadeaway air shot across the map. And you know, your medic is dead. And I don't like leaving that sort of thing up to chance when I can play forward, I can play really, really aggressive and get up on these chokes, which is like
and
a
just lock
dream.
Them, lock them out of coming in entirely instead of trying to just out-DM them when they come in.
Yeah.
Okay. Can you talk a little bit about how to deal with a sniper? I know a lot of... If you're playing against a good sniper on this map, it can be really, really difficult for like a roamer, especially trying to jump across. So is there any sort of tips you would get for, I don't know, denying a sniper or keeping him, you know, out of the equation?
You don't really get to deny a sniper on this map. I mean, it's not like you can just deny a sniper, right? The only two spam spots is, you know, one right there, one against the wall, that covers, like, the easy sniper vantage point of over here, where they can see lots of stuff. But there's so many different sniper spots. Like, all you could know is maybe he's sitting, I don't know, like, against this window right here, right?
Yeah.
And he's crouched. And now he can also see bottom right, kind of. There's a lot of crazy sniper spots, so you kind of, as roamer, you kind of have to take a chance that sniper's gonna get his shots off. Because I would place, unless that sniper's having like a really, really good day, I would place the consistent damage of a roamer is more important than a sniper's occasional headshot on a push. Because I mean, yeah, he might get one headshot and kill a player, but at the same time, you're consistently doing damage, and you have the ability anytime to jump in and make a play. And I think, like, if you can shut down the sniper and you have the opportunity, that's great, but at the same time, I don't feel like you should take your life for it unless it's Paula or someone else who's equally having, like, a really crazy day and headshotting your entire team over and over again, which I think is pretty rare.
Okay.
But, you know, jumps to kill the sniper, stuff like this. You know, you can do double jump off the left wall and make it really easy onto that. Or, I guess, I actually don't know very many double jumps on this map to kill a sniper because I've never really focused on it that much. I focus more on spamming him, and that way his aim keeps on getting, you know, juggled up and down a little bit, and that might give your team the chance to push in without any headshots.
Okay, is there any off-classing like exceptions you would do? Like, would you ever substitute the pocket for like a heavier, or would you ever drop the roamer for, like, what would you drop the roamer for, like a spy player or a sniper or anything like that? Do you like any of those other loadouts? Can you just talk about that for a few minutes?
I don't really prefer any other rollouts other than gunboats on this map. Gunboat Soldier, I think, is just too good. You have so much mobility, you can make so many plays. Like, at any time, you can just make a play like this, and now you're at the enemy health pack. Or, let's say you get your health back, now you can just do this. And then you can get right onto mid.
I think once you're behind him, you also have tons of options. You know, you can just delay and come in when your team pushes, or you can jump up behind their house and try and kill a sniper. If their medic's holding underneath a bridge, then and you get to the left kit, then you're just one rocket jump away from trying to force him. Any sort of spy or NG or anything like that viable in this? I think Pyro's generally ruled out on Vitek just because it's so open, it's not choked up at all. Any other off-classes, though?
I think Heavy would be viable sometimes. It depends on how your team wants to play it. I like to play super aggressive on chokes and stuff, so the splash damage is way too important for teams I usually play with than a Heavy would be. And, you know, corners are the Heavy's worst friend, right? But if you're playing on a choke, there's going to be a lot of corners, so it doesn't really work out too well. Unless you can manage to get, like, a Heavy on the cliff, right? I guess that'd be the best position ever. But then, at the same time, you can't... It's not like you have that instantaneous damage of a soldier jumping out of choke. You give up your choke advantage just for height advantage with the Heavy, which I don't think is all that useful.
Yeah, it's also much slower if they do manage to get through the chokes to get back to the point if you need to get out. If they get, like, an early sniper pick or something.
Yeah.
You're kind of committed to holding aggressively, and then you can't protect your medic when he's trying to retreat across the point as well as you could if you're on a soldier. What else exactly. Can you talk about on soldier, though?
Pushing, I think.
Pushing?
Like,
yeah, go
just
for
straight
it.
Up pushing. Like, let's say they have, I don't know, if they're holding up aggressive, I think pushing mid is probably your best option, even though it seems kind of weird. Because pushing either of these sides, the choke is a lot less. And basically, if a soldier's sitting here, he doesn't have the easiest spam angle to kill you. And it's not like he can jump in either on you and get you as you're coming out this choke unless he jumps like that. But that's kind of suicidal by him. I mean, it's different where, let's say the pockets jumps this way, he can play on top of this crate and spam, and there's nothing you can do about it. And same thing with over here. If you push cliff, he can jump up top here, and he's safe while spamming the choke. But if you push mid, he can't easily get on you unless he's playing against this, right? If you're playing against this, you can spam him back because there's a wall behind him.
Mm-hmm.
So I really like pushing mid. The only thing you have to worry about is scouts, roamers heading there. You have to check
sticky traps. Yep.
And then when you're coming out, you have to check both sides, and then tire and on top, and behind that crate.
Yeah, it's a lot to clear. When I like to push mid, I like to make sure I send like a scout or roamer out either left or cliff. Like if I think they're holding cliff, I like to send people to the left just to get eyes on stuff and try and check a lot of those gay spots so you don't have as much to do when you come out on pocket and you can just go towards mid.
Yeah, exactly. And when you get those flank, when you get your teammates flank on the left, I mean, that frees you up, because I mean, these people are probably going to be spamming you either from up top or over here, and the first thing you're going to want to do is you're going to high ground and start pushing mm-hmm. them back by pushing out top. But if you go top, your medic's vulnerable, but not if your flank's over here and they can support him. And when you're pushing into mid, generally I would never, almost never push this side. It's like a death trap from rollers, because rollers come in, they fly down, and then they hit this, and they're going to explode right at the bottom of these stairs, and that's not even accounting for directs. And if one direct hits you, even one pipe, your entire team's going to take like 300 damage or something from one pipe. It's crazy.
Also probably the worst thing, like it's the sniper. He has like a good 2 seconds where you're walking right there to shoot at you.
Exactly. And then, as Brad was saying, if you can, push cliff. Taking over cliff and then pushing up top is really, really nice. The only thing you have to worry about is this. Roamers can easily jump over it or on top of you, but at the same time, the angle, since you have height advantage, makes it easy to get air shots, so you can look cool while doing that.
Ragvid!
Exactly. The only thing you have to worry about are weird sticky spots, like right here, or maybe right there. So, but you can pretty easily clear those. I mean, as you're walking up, just throw a rocket right there in case there's stickies over here. You can look right here and hug the wall, and then right here you want to check below you. And you can jump off this, but like we were talking about in Brad's section earlier, it's kind of dangerous with stickies traps right here and here. Either way, your entire goal is to, like, if you're pushing upper, you drop right around here, and then you can start Ubering in right here. If you Uber in right there, that's like Sean said earlier, it's a pretty good push, because if you get forced way back here, then that's a problem. It's gonna take you probably 2 rocket jumps just to get onto the enemy. But if you pop right here, you can use this rock and just instantly get on top of people.
Okay, I think that's enough for a soldier. I think we'll switch it to scout in a second, but what about pushing underneath the planks, the middle, the lower, yeah, right there. You like that angle at all for pushing?
I also like this a lot. At the same time, though, you have to worry about stickies. It's really easy to get stickies
right
here.
Yeah, that's one of the
Yeah, the easy thing is, though, you just splash right there, and it'll splash all the stickies to the right, and you just have your medic hug the left wall. But on the other hand, if it's Banny or another really good demo man, he'll predict this and put his stickies right there instead. And that splash rocket that goes right here will not splash these stickies, and it's still going to be sticking no matter what. You're going to have a problem. So if you think, if you spot the demo man stickies, you know, whichever way, just go the opposite.
Or if the demo's dead, I think that's a server changing level.
Yeah,
do you have the Archon to change it back or not?
It just reset, actually. Weird.
Oh, it's... Okay, it's on the same map. So I guess that's a good time to switch to talking about Scout. Any final points about Soldier?
There's a few death traps on this map. Soldier versus Scout. Try not to get trapped. Or, like, try not to dedicate 1v1s versus Soldier versus Scout. Like, exactly where you are. If a Soldier's right here and a Scout's right there, good luck.
Yeah, this is not a good fight for the Soldier. Unless you're me and you're missing. But even then, I missed like several shots, and you still managed to die. That's a good splash angle.
Yeah, the only angle.
Yeah, if you just shoot him with the face, if you just headshot him with rockets, it's generally a pretty good fight.
So there's that one, and then try not to get dedicated in 1v1s around the rock as a roamer.
Yeah, there's a lot of terrain right here for scouts to do shit like this, and it's difficult to splash them if they play well and use the terrain effectively. You can bait them into a lot of bad rockets and get really good fights against them. So I guess we can... Let me switch my overlay here and we can talk about Scout.
Yeah, I guess as Soldier, as Roamer, try not to get caught in those situations, but as Pocket, you have your shotgun, so it's not that big of a deal. As long as
and you should have a heal advantage and probably the rest of your team near you as well.
Exactly.
Do you want to stick around and help me talk about Scout a little bit, since it's going to be like your first season scouting on it? And you can probably also provide some pretty decent insight on it. Let me talk about the initial mid-fight first, I guess. I usually go middle, like the Soldiers do as well. I think it's where you can get the deepest buff, and I mean, it's also the quickest route. I usually go bottom left. Like, if the demo's sticking me, I can usually either shoot the sticky if he puts it up there early. I can shoot the stick before I go underneath. And then if he is spamming that, if he does hit me with it, then I can still fall over to the right here. And then I'm near my medic, so when my Soldiers jump or when my Soldiers are dealing with the roamer, I can get, like, above him on cliff or something if I need to. And it's a pretty good pocket position to, like, mulch the roamer. And you can get eyes on flank. I think if you push up to the right here as you come out middle, if you come to the right, that's also you have options. It's a lot more open, so you don't take damage when you initially come in. I think you can also a rollout I've done once or twice. You can come in house here with your buff, and then just go straight up to China, and then it's a pretty good point to start. If you know you're doing an aggressive middle, you can just jump straight onto the rock from the lip or China. I'll just keep calling it China because that's what I'm used to calling it. But this direction here, also just running across the bridge. If you're playing a little more passive on middles, it's probably a good route. You're sitting here with high ground, you can deal with bombers. You kind of want to play it by ear, though. Just play near your medic, try and make sure you deal with their aggression, and then just try and stay healed. So when your roamer goes in, or when your pockets eventually jump, or when your demo gets that pick, then you can push across the point with your buff, and this is where you want to usually be doing most of your aggression on the mid fights. If you're like more of the flank scout, the passive scout, I don't like going this direction just at the start. I like going middle just to get the buff. But then you could probably push up this way. You can sometimes get locked out if there's a roamer right here quickly, which happens a lot if they gunboats to this side. So I still like going in the middle from the right or left, but you want to try working to the left here, like with your demo. Like your demo will probably be in this area or over here, probably working that side. So if you're right here, then the demo can't damage both of you. Also, if like this flank here is where a lot of roamers like to play. So if you're like right here when the roamer starts coming through, it's not a good angle to fight the roamer. You can get splashed pretty easily. I know some scouts have sat right here before waiting for the roamer. I think Ruin did this last season, once or twice. He would just jump up here at the start of the mid and then like do shit like this when the roamer started bombing in. If you're the passive scout, this is a pretty okay angle to play. You can get splashed on this, but as long as you're just using it as like a launch pad kind of for aggression, just kind of play in this general area. There's a lot of room to juke around and dodge the damage, and you can still play near your medic, so kind of protect him, and then once you're buffed, you can either follow up your, like do your own aggression, like this type of angle, and let's try and follow up on a bomb, or you can either, if you get a pick on the roamer, like if you see the roamer playing this right here, if you know he's in there, and you do an angle like this, and you don't see scouts here to contest you, then he could be a possible pick if you get a flanker on him. What would you do as scout on this middle?
I'm a huge fan of just killing roamers, because as a soldier, I always it's that soldier. You know,
yeah, you're fucking, you're scout bait on this middle. You try to, you try to just get your damage out there early, but you're scout bait. You're gonna die to scouts a lot. Scouts run this map. It's so open. There's so much terrain for them to just hide on and get a lot of hide advantage fights. But I think mulching soldiers when they try to go aggressive is probably the best option for mids. And just stay healthy, try and stay buffed, so when your team starts going aggressive, you can follow up on it, and you're not running for a health kit back here. I think that's what I would do on the initial mid. I know a lot of teams drop a scout for a sniper. I think on sniper, like initially, you want to go cliff, get this shot up, and you can either shoot towards the stairs or down here, this angle, and then if there's nothing pushing that direction, then you know you're sealing them off on the right, so your demo in your pocket can spam them to the right. And then once they're falling back on that, pitched on that side, then you want to like peek this angle and look for the sniper there first, and then just get shots on the medic right here is usually where you're gonna kill things. Just the fight in general, though, this rock is kind of where a lot of scouts try to play. Be cautious of a good pocket. He's gonna shoot rockets right there. If you guys do MGE against a good soldier, you can try to dance on this rock a lot, but they're going to be shooting rockets like this side of it here as well when you try to peek them if they're on the point. Try to just look for fights off of your teammates. Like your roamer or your demo are going to be damaging them pretty well, or your other scout is going to be flanking them. Try and get a lot of 2v1s. Don't get baited into a lot of 1v1s because you're much more powerful if you're just getting your buff and then fighting them when your soldiers are on them. You're also, if your team's in the middle of a fight, like an extended mid-fight, if you are not cleaning up a point, you need to be, like, making sure there's no sniper. Like, a lot of the time against a good sniper, I would have to do shit like this and come up here and try and, either flank the sniper and get a good two-shot on them, or if they're pushing cliff, that's, like, a good angle to try and maybe come in behind the med when they're pushing up cliff. You can, like, the pocket will jump in, and then you can get free shots on the medic and get them to pop pretty early. There's a lot of room back behind them. There's two health kits. There's a house to hide in. I think it's a pretty good map for scouts, I'd say.
Yeah.
So that's kind of takes care of the mid fights. What about holding? If you're holding aggressively, I think you said if you're kind of the flank scout, I think this angle is probably the best. You can watch that, but you'll probably have your teammates over there in that direction, holding it from high ground. This right here is the reason this angle is good, because you can watch this and call it very early. And your roamer will probably be spamming it right here. But this right here is where you can spot, like you can have your pocket, your demo shift their damage to that choke before they get out of it. So if you call this when they peek that right there, then they're going to be shifting spam right here, and they won't get a free entry into the point. What were you going to say, Brennan?
I was going to ask you, what do you think the second scout should play then?
The second scout, I like playing on just up here. Like, I like playing here. I can pounce on a... If they try to contest this with just the flank, then I can come in from this direction. If I'm playing just in-house, I think it's important for the second scout to not die or get a force. Either... You have to coordinate this with your team to know if you're just trying to get a force on the medic when they come out and then get your medic out. But if you have Uber, then you're probably going to be playing this really strong. And you're probably not going to be involved in much of the Uber right here. These chokes right here, if the team tries to commit to... Like, it's much better to Uber pocket in this area. You can make them split with, like, two or three rockets. Also, the demo, like, it can just deny them the choke entirely. It's good to just stay alive post-Uber on this map, I noticed.
So, if you're the second scout, you'd say the ground is lava?
Yeah, the ground is hot lava. That's a good... Yeah, I'd probably just try and play high ground. You can do shit like this. If they're pushing main and they exchange Ubers, you can force the pocket to look at you. If they push past you, you can drop down and gate the demo here, stuff like that. Fighting the flank with your roamer and your other scout is really important. Try and just keep a health advantage on them, I'd say. A lot of the times I would just try and stay stacked. If you notice Enigma on this map, he is like orbiting his medic almost like the entire time. Whenever old mix-up would play this, which they were like pretty much unbeatable on, it was always Moose and their roamer. Who was it? Anyways, it was Moose and maybe Harblue or someone would always get the force in this area here and this area right here. Enigma would always be the one pocketing. He'd be like on the point with the medic, making sure none of the follow-up aggression comes in and gets to him.
What do you think about pushing as scout?
Pushing as scout? I like coming off a cliff. If I can get a... Like, usually when we do, like, suicides, I like getting the buff and then the metal retreat out of spawn right about here. And then I like coming this direction, just because I can, like, I can watch my bombs and see where they're doing the damage when I get to about right here. And then I have the option of, you know, just jumping off a rock, unless there's a sticky trap there. But then I have the option of doing shit like this and jumping over to the right and just trying to follow up their damage. Underneath is the quickest. Like, I like going this way on a lot of middles, unless the demo's denying it entirely. I only go to the right if my roamer goes first. Like, if my roamer's clearing this, like, if he takes this health kit, then I come out here with him, and we can fight this a little bit. I think it's much better to go cliff, or even off of, China. Like, if you get your buff right about here, and your team's doing a push, I like to go this direction, and just jump on the rock and just try and follow up with the rest of my team.
The only thing with that is, when you're doing it, make sure you're at the back of the catwalk, not hugging the thing, because that splash can go through it.
Yep. I don't even walk on the bridge a lot. You can just do this jump and avoid that entirely.
Oh, true.
There's a few cheeky rollouts. I probably should talk about that. There's a little cheeky rollout you can try. If you know the team's going to be running a sniper, if they've done it every round, then later on you can try stuff like this, where you jump up top, and then you can do like this rollout where you... Like, you do this, and now you're on their sniper, like, right from the get-go. And even if you don't kill him, it forces the pocket to shoot rockets at you. I think you can just jump straight up here, too. Yeah, that's pretty good. It's probably a little easier to do.
That's actually a spot a soldier I always play on.
Up here? You know,
point is, say it's overtime, and they have to come to the point, I always sit up there and just spam the point, because they have to go sit on it.
Yeah.
That's a really good rock.
What else can we talk about as scout?
How about, well, I guess that was the retake. We have holding aggressive. What about, let's say they're holding aggressive and you want to push just out of spawn?
If you're trying to get out of spawn?
Yeah.
I like coming this way ahead of my pocket. If I know we're going to push, I like coming this direction and just trying to clear, like, a sticky trap or at least look for it, because I think it's better if you eat a sticky trap than your medic or your pocket, obviously. Because your spawns are also really quick. That's a good point about just in general on Viaduct. You want to play the spawns a lot. Like, if they have the point capped, your spawns are so much faster than them. It's not terrible if you die early on a push, because you're just coming up at the end of it. Like, if you die here to a sticky trap, then your medic and your roamer or your pocket can get out here and have a decent Uber at least to try and get to the point or get to the medic and force. And then at the end of the Ubers, you're going to be pretty much coming back up here to your medic, and you're going to be here at the end of the fight, which is not terrible. So if I'm coming out main here, I like to, like, look here really quickly, and then I just look backwards and try and check all the gay spots for my pocket. And then I can kind of stand here and get a buff with the medic, and then there's multiple directions to try and push. But I was never an amazing scout, so maybe you have some better ideas of how to break an aggressive hold.
No, I think that's actually pretty good.
Yeah,
the big thing is you have to just get out there, right? Like, you can't just get in the choke, because then you're all eating.
Yeah, if you're coming cliff, you can't dick around right here. You're bait for sticky spam, roller spam, and like a soldier high ground is usually like a soldier right there and a demo right there. Is like the staple of an aggressive hold. So coming through chokes like this, you have to have a buff, and you have to just get here quickly and just try and make room for your team. You're not going to be able to sit here and, you know, DM them in this area. You're just going to take the rockets from the height. Coming the far right is probably the best route to help your flank out. If you know they're holding, like, just a roamer here, if they're holding all the way back here, then this is probably the safest direction. You might eat a rocket for like 30 or 40 when you come through. But then you have a kit, and you have options to come over to the left and get to your medic here.
Do you have any really cool, like, suicide paths? Like, you know, you have that gimmicky mid rollout where, in case you know the enemy team is running a sniper, do you have anything like that for just suiciding on the enemy medic?
If your team is overloading the left with, like, suicides, I think it's pretty good to sneak in here. Like, if you can sneak in, like, this area. Like, usually you don't get spotted until you're, like, right here. And then at that point, you can start getting shots on the med on the point. Also up this, like if they're down one or two when you're trying to do plays for pushes, which they probably are. Like if it's like a post mid fight where, let's say it's a post mid fight where you both lose medics. So if it's actually a push and they're two, that's not really what you asked though. It was suicides.
I mean, it's all pretty much.
Yeah, it's all about whatever. The same. You probably should have quick response if you're doing suicides. So let's assume they're down one or two. If they're down one or two, then I think coming this route is pretty safe. You're probably not going to get contested by too many things. And if your bombs are aggressive on cliff, or if your demo, like Brad said, is coming in this direction, usually a lot of teams will hold the medic over on this side. They don't hold aggressive a lot on this side, right? So I think coming in from this direction, either underneath here or like this direction here up the stairs, if you can sneak in without being seen until like right here, then that's really, really good. Like you can come in here and try and pot shot or meet shot the medic as he's taking rockets. It's I think, like I'll say, when I started scouting here, I was asking like other scouts for advice, and Sizer put it really simply. He said, shoot at people when they're not looking at you, and I think that's just a good point to take into mind, or to keep in mind when you're like doing a lot of these DM fights that get extended on the point. It's just you don't have to create a lot of openings on your own. You can wait for your roamer to go and then just follow up, and then if you get this like if you take over this section of the map, the right side concrete or whatever you want to call it, with your roamer, and they're having a combo fight like an Uber versus Uber over in that section of the map, then just be ready to pounce. Like the pocket's going to be probably involved in like an Uber versus Uber fight in like this area. So if you come out this side with your roamer, like, and like do shit like this, like this is where a lot of scouts get their kills, coming in from the right, and then they'll pounce on the medic when he's trying to fall back. So routes like that are pretty powerful as far as pushes go. What else can we talk about? Clearing stickies is important. Getting eyes on, just getting intel. I like, especially if you're running crits, I don't like blind pushes on this map. I feel like buff scouts have enough room that they should be able to get pretty decent intel, so the push isn't just forced. Like if you get forced right here as a medic, then I would probably put that on my scouts to just, I feel like someone on my team dropped the ball. If I'm getting forced here instead of getting forced here, which is far more ideal, then I think someone probably should have either eyed out the sticky trap or spotted the roamer flying in beforehand. Off-class options, sniper obviously is pretty good. Up on cliff is usually where they hold. If you're holding aggressive on sniper, this is a really cheeky angle to body shot from. Also right down here if they push lower. Spy is kind of situational. You can get behind them. There's an ammo kit right here. There's an ammo kit on the other side. There's two of them. And you can just uncloak behind them as your team's pushing. And if the medic's trying to milk, like if they're healing the pocket and demo and falling back this direction to try and get a good Uber versus Uber, then, I mean, that's when you want to uncloak in house and come out and try and just backstab them with your pan. anything else to talk about on Scout? I don't think so. I think that's about it for Scout.
Yeah, it's, I don't know what else.
It's very Scout-centric. Make sure you're... You probably want to be near a medic. If you can keep scouts healed when the fights get extended, once the soldiers get their rockets out and do damage, once the demo, you know, gets his trap and starts getting the roller damage out there, if you're healed at that point, then your team has a pretty good leg up on the fights. Let me switch it to medic, and we'll talk about medic a little bit.
Medic on this map is really hard.
Yeah, it's a difficult medic map. I think, let's just talk about against snipers. I think just in general, knowing how to push against the sniper is pretty important. Whenever I push, let's just assume the other team's running a sniper. We've already done suicides, so now my team is pushing with Uber. Yes, Zixter, we've gone over Roamer. There'll be a VOD later. But let's say pushing is medic. I like cliff or main. I think main has the most potential. As long as your team, like your scout and your pocket, are being cautious about all this shit. Stickies right there, stickies right here, gay spots right here and here. As long as your pocket and your scout are on top of things, I think pushing out main is the safest, because there's really no angles for the sniper. If you hug these crates, the sniper can't shoot you from middle, and he has to be holding really, really aggressively up there, or aggressively like on your cliff or something, and that probably won't be the case. So it'll probably be at least back on point. So pushing... Hang on. I always talk so much when I do these. My mouth is so dry. I think pushing. I think pushing this direction, if you hug the wall and get to like right here as med without getting popped by the roamer or a scout, then it's pretty good to push against the sniper. You can either drop down this way if he's on cliff and you could pop right here, which isn't terrible. You can also come house and you can see him. Like if you see him staring at you right here, you know, just pop out the door. If you go cliff, master this jump as medic, by the way. I apparently need to work on it before Vidic tweak. But if you just surf up the rock a little bit, then you can come here and hold aggressively. But anyways, for pushing against a sniper, if I come out cliff, I always make sure my pocket checks this, and if he says I'm clear, that's when I cross. I've gotten body shot by here too many times to cross without having someone tell me it's clear. So I always have someone clear that angle for me. And then once I'm here, it's pretty safe until, like, usually the sniper's in a default spot, which is China on the other side. So if you just hug this wall and pop around the corner, you don't want to chance dropping someone at this point to a sticky trap. So I'd say pop your pocket when he's about right here, because he's going to be dropping down. And then even if you Uber him right there, he can do one RJ and he can be, you know, on top of them with height advantage, which is a pretty good position for the first few seconds of an Uber, wouldn't you say?
Oh, yeah. If you can get on top of them, it's amazing.
Yeah, if you can get to right here before popping, I think it's a pretty good push. That's kind of the goal of medic is to get... Like, there's kind of a line on this map where if you can get to, like, right here without being forced, that's kind of the goal for most of your pushes. Let's see. For going out the far right, I don't do that a lot as medic. I'd say we always... Well, at least I, on my past teams, have always gone main or cliff with the med. If you don't have Uber, let's say you died on middle, but their medic survived. So if you have to do suicides to get Uber advantage, don't commit past this entrance. If I'm right here and a roamer bombs in, I can probably get back to spawn with a scout who will probably be body blocking this anyways. If I come to right here though, a roamer could bomb in or a demo could bomb in and kill me without me getting out. So I would buff people if you're doing suicides. I'd buff people either out main or up to this section of cliff, and I wouldn't commit past this door. If you get to right here and you have people over heal, that's good enough. I would just go back to spawn and build in spawn. If you come out main, it's pretty much the same drill. If you come to right here, roamer or pocket could bomb in and put a rocket on there and juggle you. So I'd probably come about right here and no further if I was doing just suicides. I wouldn't push out the right. I think we talked about pushing against the sniper. Let's talk about holding, I guess. I like to hold, if neither team has Uber, I like to hold right about back here. If it's more of a passive hold, a lot of teams won't be as coordinated as like an invite team to do an aggressive hold. If it's more of a passive hold, which I'm assuming most open IM teams, low-level teams, are going to be shading towards, I think holding right here is pretty good for medic. You can just sit here on your pocket. You can control this. You can spam against the sniper. You can also just heal your demo, which is putting traps up right here, even against that wall there. So it's a pretty good angle to hold and just deny them entry in the middle for free.
Well, the first thing, I would just never get caught around that corner.
Right here?
Yeah, because if you don't have any sight, and then you can't know if a soldier is about to jump in or not until someone actually calls it, versus you just being a little bit around that corner, and you're pretty much safe from all the spam anyway, because they don't have the angle to splash you on the ground. They have to direct
you. Yeah, that's true. The only thing I don't like is if I'm playing against a sniper, if I think the team is ever going to run a sniper, I don't like playing in this area. I think holding right here, playing too close here isn't probably that good, but I guess playing here is also about the same thing, and you're healing your pocket still, and you're not, you know, against the wall where a roamer can just land on top of you. So if you're right here and you see a roamer flying in, then you can maybe come in here, or you can, like, come back underneath the bridge and try and hit a surf back to this area. Where else? Just consider sniper lines whenever you're holding things, against a sniper especially. Right here is safe, you know, quote-unquote, against a roamer, probably not so much. This is, you have a lot of room to maneuver here against soldiers that try to push you, and a sniper can't really peek you just because you're below the horizon, I guess, so he can't get an angle on you. Also right here, this kind of blocks the China route, so if you're pushing and you get to right here, you can maybe try and walk here and keep milking it, but I probably wouldn't chance that too much. I've seen teams do this hold, where you just put your medic right here and you just have him on your pocket right here and he's not going to take any splash. But I think it's a free force for a roamer, and if they push cliff, if they push cliff with the sniper or something, you can get kind of pinched in to standing here, and then Yeah, I don't know if it'd be a good Uber at that point. Once I have Uber, I like to hold more aggressively. Like, I like to push up to at least, like, right here. This isn't bad. I can sit here, and I don't think the sniper can get an angle on me. Also, I have my pocket right here, which is ready to jump him if he tries to push me. Right here is the angle you have to worry about. If you back up a little bit, I think that kind of blocks it. Just kind of listen to your team's comms. You want to have a scout roamer holding up, trying to make sure that they just calm where everything's coming. Like, if I'm playing medic right here, and I see the in my scout or roamer call that the medic's coming out to the right, then I'm probably going to start pushing towards this side with my demo in my pocket, just to get a good early trade on them over in this area, or a good early force. I haven't talked about it with our team this season, though, so I mean, this could all be different. You said you like to hold pretty aggressive, like, here is pocket, so if you're holding up here, like, would you put the medic here, or would you put him in just in-house? That's probably not very good. Like, is this the best angle for medic, just right here?
So yeah, you can't pretty get much. Just like, right next to your pocket.
Just watch this angle here for sniper. If you're right here, then I don't think he can be sniped from pretty much anywhere, unless he's really, really aggressive somewhere.
I think most of your medic survivability on this map isn't going to come from your medic... Like, your medicing ability, it's going to come from your teammate's ability to calm and be watchful for you. Because there's just too many angles, too many places that a roamer can come flying out of on your medic. You just have to, your entire team has to be on top of it for your medic to have the least amount of deaths possible.
Yeah, I think having the roamer in areas like up here, the roamer or the scout, getting early comms on where the push is coming from or where suicides are coming from. Like, if I have a roamer or a scout on cliff and they say, you know, they're pushing left, if I think it's suicides because I have Uber and we just killed our medic, then at that point I'm probably just going to start hightailing it the other direction to try and not get forced. Like, if I get to back here and someone, like, if they call suicides and I'm on this side of the point, I'm just going to, like, turn and run to this side and try and just keep running away from the push. And hopefully my team can screen the scouts, pot shot the roamer and the demo as they come flying in to just try and... Get the kills cleaned up before I get forced.
Yep. The only thing I would say is, let's say you're holding back as medic. As a roamer, you'd want to be sitting right around here in this area. Because that way you can calm whichever side they're coming from, and you have this wall to easily backwards RJ out, so you're safe. And you have opportunities for pretty much everything from that angle. Like, you could do literally everything as a roamer in that spot. Like, you can jump, you can spam them back up. You can call suiciders, everything.
I think it was, I was talking about pushing a little bit. If you can get to like right here without popping, that's really, really good. I think that's a point to consider when you're holding yourself. If you think they're going to Uber push, if you know their med, if they just did suicides and they didn't get you, so it's an Uber versus Uber exchange, then I would not dick around sitting back here trying to milk an Uber. I would try and keep high ground, and if the team starts pushing up this direction, this is where you want to Uber around the corner and force the medic. You want to force him back here so his team, like, has a roamer behind him and a scout flanking from this direction. You don't want to let him get all the way to the point with a buffed pocket and a demo right behind him and scouts fighting on the flank. You want to go into them with view of Uber.
Yeah, I think absolutely. In most cases.
I know Brad's teams in the past, Flo and then Mix Up last season, they were kind of unbeatable on this map because of their aggressive pushes. They would really punish teams if they're holding mid and the team starts pushing out from the left. They'll just do, like, Ubers around the corner and they'll Uber exchange in this area here and then just fall back to point to two buff scouts and to, like, 10 sticky traps in these areas. And it's really hard to get a good safe push into middle if you Uber aggressively on them. It's a pretty good crits map. If you're critsing, I think just pushing off a cliff is probably the best, because you can get to, like, right here before you pop it, and then you just pop on your demo and he's shooting crit stickies at this angle or at this angle here if they're holding on the back right. What else can we talk about on mid? Just buffing priorities, I guess. I usually like to prioritize the roamer just to make sure I can get him. If I'm holding with my pocket, like, my pocket's probably going to be here, just if I have Uber. He's probably going to be here next to me waiting to take the Uber anyway, so I'm not going to be too worried about his buff. If we're holding aggressively, maybe I'd be more worried about it. I like to prioritize the scouts to get them 185, because if I have a 185 scout over here, that is much better than having a scout hugging the rock here calling for a buff. So if I can get scouts buffed, they can come up here and spot aggressively. and try and, you know, get early intel on which direction they're pushing from. And then that gives us a much better chance of having a good aggressive Uber. If I get the Roamer 300 when I think he's gonna like jump a sniper or force them on cliff, like if the scouts call that they're coming out left, I like to give the Roamer a quick flash so he can jump on them and get a force up here, and then maybe just tank my demo so he can send rollers and stickies here.
Yeah, pretty much this spot, period. Like having your soldier right here and having your medic sit around back here is really, really solid for if it's just equal Ubers or you don't have the time to push up to here but you're still somewhat even. You want to be sitting right around here, and if you want to play defensive you should be all the way back. You shouldn't sit around the point because that's just death trap like we talked about earlier. But yep. Here as soldier you have this angle, you can spam all the way in, then you can turn to the right and spam the health pack as well, and it's so easy just to spam that and that for spamming people who are coming cliff, as well as your demo man who can easily spam rollers.
Yeah, I think a good point just in general about team play that also makes medicing here so much easier is just getting early intel. Like, having scouts and roamers buffed up here means that you know, like, as long as they're calming, which they should be, then you know which direction they're coming from and you know if the push is coming. So if you're buffing people here against suicides, if they call suicides, that's when you need to be here. Like, if you're up here when you see a roamer come flying in at you, then someone missed the call or you were a little out of position. If they call suicides, then at that point you want to start playing more back here. And then once you hear people start jumping, you know, come into house and shit like that, try and have your pocket just mulch people as they try and get you to pop. Also, if you don't have Uber, then you kind of want to maybe hold a little differently. Like, once you have Uber, holding here is good because you want to have an aggressive push on or aggressive hold against them. But if you don't have it, you probably want to be shading towards your side of the point. Just to maybe guard against the crits push a little bit, or just play a little bit safer until you do have that charge.
The other thing you also need to worry about is medic. Like, let's say you're talking about how if they're suiciding, you instantly want to back up. Suicides also can really easily look like just people pushing. Like, they could easily, yeah. Like, it could just be suicides, but they could be suiciding four people, but they might not even go for you. They might go for anyone else who's just close by.
They might not even be prioritizing the medic. Yeah, if you're not healing your team, if they turn it into three picks with dropping like one, then maybe it'll turn it into a push. Like, you can push on numbers on this map really easily. You don't have to wait for Uber a lot. That's a good point, actually. If both medics die on middle, you don't need to wait for an Uber to go. You just need to get your six buffed and go. I think making sure you have people healed at the start of pushes is important, because a lot of times the roamer will go down before you can get hooked up with them again. The scouts will get over on this area of the map, and you'll be on the left with your demo in your pocket. So it's kind of hard to keep them involved in the fights later on. Sometimes they can get extended a little, maybe I'd say. But if you buff them early, then it's probably they probably have some sort of advantage over there. Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say it's even viable on this map to push non-Uber versus Uber, like 6v6, with just having your medic play a little more passive than usual, and then he can just easily fall out. Because, I mean, all you really need your medic is, like, let's say you just start walking out and they're not holding aggressive, but they have Uber. It's so easy for a medic and his team just to come out to here, buff his team, and then he leaves, and now it's a five-man push versus you. And say the medic can just get out later. If you just be really aggressive with Ubers, at least that's the way I like, really enjoy playing, is being highly aggressive with Ubers, because you can get in people's faces and you can get up on chokes, and it leaves less room for their medic to get out, as well as I just really like it.
Yeah. I think a good point for during Ubers, for like flashing, I think let's do during pushes, I guess. Would you probably flash the pocket around corners like this? If he gets it right here, you're probably going to Uber your pocket and he's going to go into them to try and get the force.
Yeah, because there's too many trap locations. If you stop and you check every single one of these spots like this,
you're going to be getting crushed from over here.
Exactly.
Yeah. So what about scout Ubers? Do you like scout Ubers on this map? Well, kind of a lot
really
of ground to cover.
That much.
Like, if we push two scouts underneath this side, is that a good push? If they get to right here when we pop on two scouts?
It depends on, if you get to here before you pop, that'd probably be fine, because then our scouts can just double jump straight up onto here and everything. But it's still, it's kind of risky, because It's just so consistent for a soldier. I mean, all he has to do is RJ and he's right on top of the medic, and all it takes is a really couple of good body blocks from like one soldier. Like if their medic's over here, all he has to do is run into house and he has a soldier body block this. Now you might not even get that medic. It really depends. It's just pretty risky.
I think during pushes then, retaking the point, I think it's important to keep your soldier Ubered for like the long duration of it. I think you're going to have to Uber him around the corner here, and he's going to have to do a pretty long jump to get back here and try and get damage on the med to force the pop, right? And then you're going to have to probably fish him out of here. I think keeping your demo alive at the end of the Ubers is really important. He's also the best option on the team to protect you. I think if you have a demo here at the end of the Uber, usually when I Uber my demo, or when I Uber on my pocket, I don't want to extend past here. I don't want to commit to, you know, having a Uber fight up in this area, because if my Uber ends when I'm right here, then there's probably a roamer, you know, somewhere about to rape me, or a scout coming in from this direction. So if I Uber my pocket, I probably want to fall back with the last 20% of it to a demo, which would be right about here. And having a demo traps at this line right here is probably about where you want to have your stickies. And if your demo has this trapped, then it's really hard for them to counter aggression on you and get a kill after the Uber if you just focus on controlling the point with like a demo and a scout.
Yeah, it's not just the like stickies either, because during this Uber, when you're like, say, pushing up really aggressive, once the Ubers wear off, your scout's going to be running in, and they're going to be running in near the point, because they want to get cap time.
Yeah, you're going to be, you probably Uber the pocket, and then you fall back to like the demo at the end of the Uber, and then probably a scout or two to just try and get them the laid buff, and then they can clean up on the pocket's damage after the Uber and the roamer.
So what haven't we covered on this map?
I think that's about it. That was 15 minutes in each class. This is probably plenty. Let's do some questions from chat. Do you guys have any questions? Let's see. Does it ever make sense to run a heavy? I know, was it Slingle's team that ran a heavy, like, full-time? Did pretty well with it?
It works. It just depends on how your team wants to roll with it, because your entire team around the heavy.
Yep, heavy works. You have to change your team loadout. Like, your Ubers are going to be so much different. Defensive Ubers with a heavy are okay. Like, if you have a heavy right here at 450, they have to, like, if your demo or scouts force them right here, or a good sniper, if you have a sniper, a really good sniper on your team, I think heavy is pretty strong, because you can screen really well for them. If you have a heavy right here, and their Uber is forced back there on their side of the point, then once they get to right here, you can Uber the heavy around the corner, and they're not capping. Like, they're not going to cap against the Uber heavy, and then once the Uber's over, he's 450, and that's still a lot of stuff to deal with. And some teams aren't as good as focus firing heavies as others, you know. It's just an important point to consider during your push. If you know they have a heavy, just try to force the medic, not the heavy, and then once the Uber's over, you're going to have to call a focus fire and everyone's going to have to kill him at the same time.
Yeah, there's only really like two ways of dealing with heavy. It's either you all focus him or you all ignore him, because he just has such a high health pool that everyone has to be on the same page. If only one guy's damaging him, it's not like you're going to kill him by yourself. He's got 450.
Let's do... Are funboats necessary? I think they are. I think
gunboats?
I think it's a really, really strong gunboats map. You can play shotgun, but I think there's enough health packs to play shotgun, I think, but... And you can kind of just 1v1 scouts, but I think it's more effective to just do gunboats and just collect health and just be a nuisance. There's a lot of double jump spots to be the initiator for your team's fights. You have to jump a lot to get to the sniper if they're running a sniper. There's two health packs behind them you can jump to just get 100 and then retreat and come back into the fights. If you get behind them, then you can jump up to house and you can bomb back in from the house to the point. I think gunboats are too strong to not run them.
I'd argue that you would never, ever, ever, period, should take off gunboats as sixes and soldier, period. Assuming you're roamer, not talking about pocket. Pocket running gunboats is pretty interesting. It can actually work on this map. I've seen teams like Bro do it. You just run really, really aggressive, non-stop bombing in with two soldiers. Although I still think shotgun is probably better. Yeah, I would argue never take off your gunboats on any map. It's just way too good to give up, especially for mobility.
Running a sniper versus a roamer scout, do you think it's situational, or just does it depend on how good your sniper is?
I think it depends on how good your sniper is and how well he's playing that specific day. Like, if he's landing all the shots, then why wouldn't you run one, right? But on the other hand...
It's a really powerful sniper map if you play around him. If you just ditch him and he dies a lot to scouts and roamers, then he's not going to be as effective as if you screen for him and make sure scouts aren't on his dick. But if he's sitting up here... in the sniper spot, the standard sniper spot, just pot-shotting after the Uber. Like, if your Uber exchange is up there on their side of the point, and the sniper's just here taking shots all day, then, yeah, run a sniper, and hopefully he hits his shots. If he's not hitting his shots, he could be much more effective on Roamer or Scout, though. About for... We used to have kind of a rule of thumb where we had a decent sniper on one of my teams in the past, and we kind of had a rule of thumb where... For pushing, we keep him on Scout, I think, or Roamer. I think it was Davis was the Roamer on, like, Flame Idiot, and he would sometimes snipe, but I think he only sniped if we were holding. So for pushing, we would keep him on Soldier, and then for holding, maybe switch him to Sniper and just make their push. Like, sometimes a Sniper can even scare him into popping. Like, if I'm a medic, if I'm walking up underneath the cliff over there, pushing against a Sniper, he might scare me into popping just to not chance dropping it against him.
Yeah, I don't know. I've never had really solid snipers on my team. The only one I had was in Season 5. I had Pokey, who was really good that season on land, a sniper. And to support him, I think we ran, during the season, we ran two heavies to support him next to him. And he was that good. We just, like, twirled around him with two heavies plus medic. But that was sort of our gimmick strat in Season 5. But outside of that, I mean... I think Brad had this rule of thumb where it's like you take three shots and each person on the team would call out when you took a shot and you would just be like, that's one, and then you got three. You have three shots to get a headshot or else you're done.
I like that. I like that rule of thumb. What about running? Is it good to combat a sniper with your own sniper? Like if you think you're pushing it to sniper, do you like trying to counter-snipe him? I think it slows down the retake too long. But I think if they're running a sniper, if you can get into them without getting domed, without your med getting killed, I think you have an advantage once the fight starts if you can get in the sniper's face.
It's like, would you rather have both of the team snipers just waving their dicks at each other, doing absolutely nothing other than trying to kill each other, or would you rather have just their sniper landing some shots on your team, but on the other hand, you have either a scout or a roamer doing consistent damage to the enemy team nonstop?
Yeah. I think...
I almost always love... It's like... A sniper isn't necessary for countering a sniper. You just have to just kill them or just push out the team. They're going to be missing a class. They're going to be missing either spam or they're going to be missing something from their flank. And you just see whichever one they switch out and you focus your play on whichever one they're missing.
That's a good point, too. Yeah, kind of consider if it's the Roamer or if it's the Scouts that they dropped. Or maybe the Debo. Maybe it's 2007 and they subbed out the Debo for a sniper.
Hey, man. Back then, they quick switch.
CPUL, double sniper. No. What if, let's see, what are the questions we have? I think it's enough talking about snipers. Snipers just depends on if you have a good one on your team that can hit his shots, then maybe try it. Try it, make sure you play around it, make sure it's communicated when he switches to it so your team's not losing people aggressively. Also, a good point to consider is, look where I'm at right now, fight people where he can see you. If you're fighting people on their cliff or their health kit on the right, then he can't help you. But if you're fighting people on the point or on the right over here, then he can shoot at your target with you, either whether it be 50 damage body shots or, you know, going for the headshots on that target. So consider that. Try and just screen for him. Make them push into him. If you think they're coming out the right, focus your spam on that direction. So then either they have to rotate underneath the bridge over here. Just play off of him really well. Try and just force them to deal with your sniper. Don't just ditch him and let the Roamer kill him with two rockets. What else do we have? What do you think about pocketing the demo for most of the time, having both soldiers run gunboats? I think it'd actually be viable. You're going to have to make sure you have scouts building or make sure he's building with rollers really well. I think demos can kind of run the show here if you get him a lot of heals. I think gunboats are also really strong, but I think you still need a pocket soldier for killing scouts. So I don't think double gunboats is a really good idea. I think having the one soldier just protecting the medic, he's going to be better at it in the long run than the demo. Killing bombers and killing scouts, I think you're going to want to keep the shoddy.
Didn't you, what was it, like Bro with Boomer and Blaze ran that for so long?
Did they?
Double gunboats on this map? Yeah.
I think it's
nonstop.
I think it is pretty good. It's a good gunboats map, and I think you're pocketing the demo and scouts so much, and the soldiers are just kind of used as, like, initiators and early suiciders, like, with the early damage. The scouts are going to be the cleanup kills. If you just go look at stats from any of the invite matches, the scouts are going to get the frags, the soldiers will probably have a lot of deaths, and the demo will have a million damage. So if you kind of consider playing around that, like, make sure you keep those roles defined. You're going to have to Uber your demo a lot, keep them alive at the end of your Ubers, and just maybe tell your pocket to ditch if he's got gunboats, then he shouldn't have any problem ditching. So maybe that'd be viable. I mean, it's something you guys could try. Just play with it. I think having a shoddy is still important, though, if you need to protect your medic a lot. But if your scouts are playing near, like they should be, you know, screening your medic from scouts and making sure they stay buffed and keep the health advantage, then I think that's a strat you could probably try. What else? How often do you get bombed? A lot. If you have Uber and their medic goes down, they're probably going to do suicides to try and reset the advantage. So work on your surfs. If you're in the point here, you probably want to try and surf a rocket up to cliff or up to just anywhere backwards. Demo bombs, just be conscious of where he's putting his stickies. Maybe even walk forward if the demo bomb's over your head. Watch for the secondary cleanup. Watch for two scouts coming in to follow up a bomb. What else do we have here? I think that's it for chat questions. Let me pull up the thread. While you have the point capped, is it better to hold behind your own rock or a bit more forward? We talked about that. I think forward holds are better if you have Uber. Just make sure if you don't have Uber, holding aggressive could bite you in the ass if you die to a roamer or a scout flank early.
I don't agree with that. I think holding forward is
still better.
Is always the best case every single time if you can get the position to do it.
What if it's only two or three of you up? If it's
then you probably can't do it. Then you shouldn't back
it. It's very situational. If once you have six, if the spawns are in your advantage or the numbers or the Uber, even the Uber, you could have Uber advantage, but if you get popped when it's just 2v6, then it's probably going to not be a very effective Uber. So if you have numbers on them, I think try and hold aggressive. I think that's a good point. Try and just lock them out, keep them in spawn, make them pop through chokes or make them drop people when they're coming in.
Even if you have Uber disadvantage, it's still going to be better for you to hold aggressive because you make them pop at a choke, then it's so easy for your medic to get out. If you force them a choke, how are they supposed to get to your medic?
Yeah.
If you force them at one of these chokes and make them pop out the door. They have to do a lot of RJs, have to get around the house, the cliff, or the right side just to get to your medic. It's safe just by making them pop that early.
Okay, so keeping numbers is more important than keeping Uber as far as holding aggressive?
Yeah.
Numbers advantage, I should say, not Uber advantage.
I would say if you have the numbers, do it.
Okay, what else do we have? What's your opinion on roamers staying on Soldier? I think we just kind of talked about that.
I love it when roamers stay on Soldier.
Greatest map ever for roamer, worst map ever. I think it's one of the strongest for sure. There's a lot of shit you can do if you get behind them. There's four health kits for you to basically collect and just be a nuisance with. Just keep bombing in and out. Do damage, try and distract, get them turned around for your scouts. Staying on Soldier. Oh, someone already answered that. Okay. Oh, you answered that. They quoted you. How and when should crits be used? If both meds go down and you need to retake the point, I guess. It's probably a pretty good situation. Just make sure you're not holding crits. If you're holding crits, you're doing something wrong. I remember during the LAN, the Bro versus LG match, Bro was actually doing a lot of really aggressive crits, as even spawn camping with it. I think they killed Shane twice in a row with like a spawn camp crits. You want to make sure to not give them Uber, because if they pop Uber into you and just kill your medic, your crits is useless. So just try and... that's again going to be on the roamer and scouts to get intel so your crits isn't a fail crits. You want to make sure to have them come where the medic is, so when you start pushing into them, you can just hit it early, and you're not guessing where the medic is or popping late, and he gets his Uber off, or he gets through the choke, and he gets people to your medic before you're popping crits.
This map in general for crits, I think just critsing your demo man. Demo mans are so good on this map with all their angles with stickies and stuff that I think just that because demo men are so good that crits becomes really good on this map.
Yeah, I think critsing off a cliff, like even upstairs isn't bad. Like if you sneak out the right and they don't force you, if you can get your demo to this area with the crit sticky, that's pretty good because the med's going to be on point or he's going to be over their rock. And the demo can kind of hit a blind crit sticky a lot. Just guessing where the med's coming from. Or even if you're holding point with crits, okay, let's do a scenario here. If both meds die on middles, if they start pushing, you're probably going to get a crits before they get the Uber, obviously, if you're building correctly. So if you pop Uber, or if you pop surprise crits on them as they're pushing, when they get about, you know, 60-70% Uber, then you can just crush a push if you surprise crits them from, like, this angle here. Like, if they start walking up choke trying to muscle you out and win the 6v6 that kind of stagnates, like, in this area, people don't want to overcommit and die. If you get a crits at that time, then that could be really, really effective. Crits is garbage if they already have Uber, I think. If you do suicides and then get a force, maybe switch to it if you're still dead. I think that's about it. Just use it. Use it to keep advantage. You don't want to let them get Uber if you're on crits. Or you want to make sure you're getting a lot of cap time with a couple critses. Like, even if the med gets Uber, if you crits and fuck up one of their pushes and the med survives, then you at least fucked up that one push and the med's going to have to use Uber to get the point back. And that's a lot of time. Like, this map's always about time, so you're always going to want to be playing Uber advantage, playing respawns to try and take it back as soon as possible. So crits works in that regard. You can surprise them to get a free 30 seconds or minute off the cap time if you land a crits or two. I think that's it, though. I don't think there's any other questions. All right, let me look at chat again. If needed, is a heavy good defense for holding the point? Yeah, we talked about that already. If you Uber heavy during the Uber, like if they push in to try and force you, if you pop your heavy in a position like this behind the rock or off the cliff, if you post them up right here, they're not going to cap. And then after the Uber, they have a 450 health, you know, gaming machine to deal with. So, yeah, I think heavy's viable at times. It's situational and your pocket has to play around it. He's not going to be getting as much Uber. Is there ever any time when the player should push all the way to their spawn? Very rarely if people are chasing the medic, but even then, I like to think of it as, if you play Viaduct around the point entirely, I think it'll work. I think even as scouts, especially, like, you want to be dying to defend the point or dying to take the point. You don't want to, like, go up here and lose a 1v1. Like, if you die up in this section when you have the point capped, then what are you doing here? Like, you know what I mean? Like, if you're forcing their Uber, maybe that's okay to die, but that's probably a job that's better for the demo spam or the pocket of the roamer. If you have the point capped as scout, I think it's much better to just stay alive when you need to be defending the point. Because if you give them a pick or two, then they can push off numbers. They don't even need Uber to push on that. Consider, like, their push as well. If you kill three right away, don't overcommit yourself and die, because their spawns are going to be much quicker if you have the point capped. And I think just in general, their push is going to be over if you kill two or three. So if you just stay alive for their next push, that's much better than dying at the end of that push for, like, one kill, because their spawn's going to be so much quicker than yours. Anything to add to that? Pushing into their spawn or pushing up past the point, I guess?
I don't think there's much of an advantage pushing into spawn outside of chasing kills that you are really depending on your aim to get that kill, because you're guaranteed to die pretty much because there's going to be people rocking out of spawn all the time. And playing at chokes is this effectively the same thing. I mean, it's almost as good as the spawn door. These chokes are so small in this map.
Pyro on this map ever? I don't think so. I don't think it's a viable class. I mean, maybe if you're doing, like, some really aggressive holds, if you keep him buffed and he locks him into one of the entrances, that could be, like, denying them if they have Uber advantage. But I think you can be so much more effective as any other class, pretty much.
It might be good even as spy. A scout. That's about it. Because, you know, you have that scout on the flank when you're holding aggressively, and then you have that scout up top who's just sort of, you know, playing up top. But if you had a pyro, I guess that'd be one of the few situations. But then it's, the question is, how do you get that pyro in that specific situation in the first place? I mean, I guess you'd have to, in some random, really, really rare scenario where you win mid and they all die and you have Uber advantage and you're holding up and only one of your scouts died, right?
Yeah, that's about it. That's about it. And even then, like, he might take so much time walking up here as pyro and not scout. Like, maybe they already come in and he's just useless at that point. And once they get through the chokes, like, what's he going to do up here? Just, like, I don't know, 360, 420, MLG, spray fire? I don't think so, right? Like, I think Sniper Spy Heavy are so much better for anything that Pyro could do. What else? NG at all? If Gunslinger was still in, maybe. Like, Gunslinger would actually be really good. But do you like NG at all for just, I don't know, for holding? I think by the time you get shit built up, they're going to be pushing and they'll probably kill your shit anyways.
Only if you're completely rolling a team and want to humiliate them.
I guess, yeah, that's a good point too. So if you want to be really, really dirty and mean to people in this video game, then switch to edgy. Yeah, make sure you build two guns.
But if Gunslinger was still allowed, I'd say it's completely viable. I'm not, yeah, there's, not better than Scout. Gunslinger, man, so good.
So for Highlander, I guess people play this in Highlander a lot, right? Like, I think Angie kind of runs the show here. You want to keep your telly up, and your dispenser is really important for the most of your team's heals.
Wrangled sentries on cliff, what do you do?
Yeah, Wrangler on cliff. Also, just shitting out gunslingers everywhere is important for the flank. But yeah, that's Highlander. This is for sixes, for ECA. I think that's it. No more questions. Thanks for watching, everybody. Thank you, Brad, for doing the demo shit so I didn't have to talk out of my ass about that. And thanks Siegel for doing a lot of the holding and the soldier parts of this map review. This will be on my YouTube, which is The Sean Bud. It'll be on Twitch VOD, which is twitch.tv/SeanBud. And my Twitter, if you want to follow that, I would appreciate it. It is at SeanBud. Also, I should plug the Laserbeam Steam group. It's the name of the group is just Laserbeams TF2, I think. Let me just double check that. Not 100%. Somebody else made the group, definitely not me, and forgot about it. Yeah, it's steamcommunity.com/group/LaserbeamsTF2. I schedule our matches as events there, and I also do announcements whenever anyone's streaming or whenever we start scrimming. I'll do announcements there. Anyways, thanks for supporting us, guys. Appreciate you. We've been getting a lot of viewers on the scrims. It's really, really nice to see. Hope you guys follow us this season. Hope the Viaduct tutorial was helpful. Anyways, hope you guys enjoyed it. Thanks for watching.